This session focuses on reward and compensation. My name is Amy Humphreys and I'm a senior lecturer at the University of the West of England. If you have any questions or queries, please do not hesitate to email me at the address on your screen. The objectives of this session are to define what is meant by the term rewards. To do this, we will consider intrinsic, extrinsic, and total rewards. A discussion as to the importance of fairness in rewards also takes place. Rewards can be defined as monetary, non-monetary, and psychological payments an organization provides to its employees in exchange for the work they perform. Rewards are often a central theme in any organization. If you think about it for a second, when somebody is asked, "Why do you go to work?" most people cite money as one of the top reasons. We know from the definition that rewards are more than this, but such a response shows how important rewards packages are to employees. Of course, for employers, employees are often their biggest expense, so management of rewards is going to be just as important to them. The association between compensation and performance furthers the importance of rewards. Adam Smith states that compensation is directly associated with performance. When added to or subtracted from, compensation will determine what the worker provides to the employer. For organisations, the main objectives from a rewards package are to attract and retain the best employees for a given job. They want to create a rewards package that incentivises their desired behaviour, quality and performance from these employees. Importantly, reward systems should also enforce organisational strategy and culture. If, for example, teamwork and collaboration is important, individual performance-related pay should not be implemented, as this is at odds with the desired culture. Used effectively, rewards can indicate to employees from the very outset what is expected and what the culture of the organisation is. Of course, one additional requirement of a rewards package is to ensure that employment law is complied with. Minimum wage, equal opportunities, and anti-discrimination laws should all be considered when designing a reward system. For employees, objectives are much more personal. Employees ultimately want a rewards package that will increase their quality of life in some way. Often, this objective is met by allowing employees to increase their purchasing power and allow them to have more options and opportunities outside of work. For many employees, rewards can enforce status both within the organisation, in terms of position on a pay scale, and outside the organisation. Outside the organisation, acquisition of material possessions can greatly enhance individual image and status. These acquisitions, of course, can only be made if they are getting rewarded at the right level. Beyond money in its purest form, employees want appropriate recognition from their employers. This is not necessarily always monetary. As we will discuss later, sometimes increased autonomy or intrinsic rewards are just as important. When individuals talk about rewards, often they are talking about compensation. However, compensation is all forms of financial returns and tangible services and benefits employees receive as part of an employment relationship. Yet total rewards are not just compensation. Total rewards are all kinds of returns or rewards perceived by the individual within the context of their employment relationship as part of a bundle. So typical compensation are elements of a rewards package that one can easily assign monetary value to. As such, these components are quantifiable and can be easily measured. Because they are tangible and observable, we say that these rewards are extrinsic rewards. They are external from the employee. Examples of extrinsic rewards include salary, pensions, cars, and stock equity, to name but a few. They are the typical elements we would see on a job advertisement or a contract of employment. However, not all rewards are extrinsic. Although extrinsic rewards are the rewards we negotiate over and are often the rewards at the forefront of our minds, there are other elements in a total rewards package. Intrinsic rewards are rewards that are internal to an individual. We cannot see them or count them, but they make up an important part of any rewards package. These rewards are the psychological enjoyment and satisfaction an individual receives from working at a given organisation. How much an individual values these will vary based on his or her own personal situation, experience, and fit with the organisation. Examples of intrinsic rewards include job satisfaction, work-life balance, quality of life, and stress levels. Although all of these are personal to the individual, organisations can greatly increase and enhance intrinsic rewards. This should lead to employees being more committed and willing to remain working for their employer. In fact, a savvy organisation may realise that putting an emphasis on intrinsic rewards may mean that less actual resources will be needed to be spent on extrinsic rewards. An example of this is the public sector. Traditionally, workers in the public sector receive below market average for their wages, and other extrinsic rewards are significantly lower than those in the private sector. Research has suggested that workers in the public sector are more willing to accept this situation because of the satisfaction they get from helping people through their work. It is also tied and linked with the status that they receive through their work. This is commonly labelled as the public sector ethos and shows us how intrinsic rewards can compensate for below average extrinsic rewards in certain situations. A total rewards package therefore encompasses both extrinsic and intrinsic rewards. A comprehensive package, according to Manus and Graham, includes total cash, direct cash, total remuneration, and total rewards. The type of employee, the organisational culture, the resources available, and the overall objectives of the organisation will affect the weighting of each component. But all should be present in a total rewards package. There are three main options when deciding how rewards are allocated: job-based, person-based, and performance-based. Job-based rewards mean that rewards are allocated based on specific jobs an employee undertakes. Under this scheme, employees perform the same jobs and they should be receiving the same rewards. Whether male, female, old or young, those doing the same jobs and tasks should be receiving the same wage. Person-based rewards assign rewards based on an individual's human capital. Human capital is defined as the unique combination of skill, knowledge, and attributes an individual brings to the organisation. It can include qualifications such as relevant degrees or professional qualifications such as the ACA accounting qualification, experience in relevant industry or occupations, and of course relevant training. Performance-based rewards tie employee reward to effort and or output, either at individual, group or organisational level. Often rewards packages are based on a mixture of these three components. For example, often organisations will implement pay scales that are job-based, but where an individual sits within a given wage bracket is determined by their human capital and their performance. In the next lecture, pay setting is considered in greater detail. Many will state that reward packages play a fundamental role in motivating employees in the workplace. However, the association between rewards and motivation will only hold under certain circumstances. The two fundamental theories that outline what these circumstances are equity theory and expectancy theory. Equity theory, coined by Adams, emphasizes the importance of fairness in any given reward system. According to Adams, there are three main propositions that must be satisfied if an employee is to be motivated by a reward system. Employees expect a fair return for what they contribute to their job. They need to receive what they consider fair compensation for the effort and energy they put into work. Employees also need to perceive that their rewards are fair compared to those of their co-workers. If an employee receives less than the co-worker who they perceive as performing at a similar level and conducting a task requiring similar skills to them, initially employees will try and rationalise this inequity. But ultimately, they will become demotivated. Interestingly, if they believe they are receiving more compared to their co-workers, in the long term they would also become demotivated. This is likely to be because if no obvious link between effort and reward is seen, employees often see no point in putting effort into their work. So how can we ensure fairness in our rewards packages? We need to make sure that rewards packages are objective and transparent job evaluations. We need to make sure that there is comprehensive performance management. And lastly, we need to clearly communicate the expectation and the reward policy to our employees. Expectancy theory by Vroom also focuses on three factors that need to hold true for employees to be motivated by reward systems. More effort must lead to higher performance. It should not be the case that if employees increase their effort, they will not be able to increase performance and meet the benchmark for increasing rewards. Vroom calls this expectancy and states that it is very important that employees are capable of meeting the goals and objectives we set them. Performance must be acknowledged and result in a high performance rating. Employees need to see that their performance will be recognised. Vroom calls this instrumentality, the need for recognition. Lastly, the outcome of performance must result in appropriate rewards. For instance, employees need to feel that their rewards justify the effort and time they have invested. This need for fairness, Vroom calls balance. According to Vroom, it is only when these three factors are satisfied that employees will be motivated by a reward system. How can we ensure that expectancy theory is met? It is all about setting clear and objective goals that employees are capable of meeting. We need to make sure that somebody is there to monitor performance, that performance is recognised, acknowledged, and results in an appropriate level of reward. In the next session, we're going to talk more specifically about wage and pay setting.